So good morning to you all once again. Today we are going to start the revision of these three chapters from Moments, Happy Prince, Weathering the Storm in Asama, as well as The Last Leaf. Okay. So first of all, we are going to revise the chapter, The Happy Prince. Okay. So The Happy Prince, why it is called as Happy Prince? Why it is called as Happy Prince? Because when Happy Prince was alive, he has never seen worry and sorrow in his entire life. Even worry, sorrow, or any kind of suffering, or any kind of, you can say, sad thing, it is not allowed to enter the king's kingdom. And ultimately, he is always happy. Okay. After the death of Happy Prince, the statue was erected on a tall column in the center of the city. It was made up of gold, and the sword hilt was containing the precious stone ruby. The eyes of the Happy Prince, they were made up of, again, precious stones which have been brought some thousands of years ago from India, that is of sapphires. Okay. And ultimately, the entire body is covered with sheets of gold. But the heart of Happy Prince, what it was made up of? It was made up of lead, which is quite heavy metal. So the Happy Prince, while standing upon that tall column, is looking over the sufferings of the people daily. And ultimately, he is feeling sorry that when he was alive, he has never witnessed any kind of suffering. He has never witnessed any kind of sorrow. But my people are suffering a lot. One day, Swallow, who was migrating to Egypt, was lagged behind of its fellow friends. And ultimately, in order to take rest, it took refuge at the base of, okay, at the pedestal or at the foot of the Happy Prince. And ultimately, the Swallow, while looking around the golden sheen of the statue, which is providing glimmering golden effect to the space, to the area around the Swallow was feeling quite elated. Swallow was also very happy that it has got a golden room today for its rest. It is really a very enjoyable place, and the air was, you can say, soft air was blowing at the top of the column where the bird was sitting. Suddenly, what happened? A drop of water fell over the Swallow. Swallow looked around and noticed that there was not even a single cloud in the sky from where this rain is pouring down, from where this rain is coming down. And when it looked upwards, the Swallow noticed that the eyes of the Happy Prince, they are filled with tears. Upon asking why Swallow, the Happy Prince announced, or Happy Prince told the Swallow that these are the tears of suffering. Because my people are suffering, this is the reason I'm not able to help them out. This is the reason or why I'm shedding my tears. Happy Prince insisted Swallow to stay on with him for one more day and not to go to Egypt the next morning and help the seamstress. The Happy Prince narrated him the story that far in that corner of the city, I'm noticing that a seamstress who is tired of working. She's working hard. She's embroidering flowers upon the satin gowns of the maids of honor of the prince, which they are going to wear during the ballroom dance ceremony. And because the seamstress is working hard, she has to finish the work well in time. But by the side of the bed, his son, who was suffering from fever, is lying on bed. He is tossing in the bed from one side to another. He is asking for oranges, but the seamstress is so poor that she did not have anything to give it to her son, and she has only the river water to give it to her son. So the Happy Prince requested the Swallow to give the precious stone ruby, which should be taken out of the sword hilt and to be given to whom? And it should be given to the seamstress. The Swallow agreed to the point and stayed for one day. The Swallow took that ruby out of the sword hilt and flew over to the other part of the city. The Swallow entered through one of the windows that was open on one wall of the, you can say, that small cottage. And after entering, it fluttered its wings and fanned the boy who was tossing in the bed and put that. The boy felt a little bit relaxed because of the air provided to him by the fluttering of the wings of the Swallow. It put the ruby on the bedside table, on the side of the table where the seamstress has put its thimble, and it flew away again. When the seamstress discovered that Ruby felt happy, she brought oranges for her son and their life came to an ease. Okay. Now, after helping that seamstress, the swallow felt quite contented. The swallow felt a feeling of satisfaction. Happy Prince told him that this is a feeling of satisfaction, contentment, which came when you help some other person. And because you have helped seamstress in need, she really needed your help. This is the reason why you are feeling so satisfied. So you can say you are feeling so poised at this point of time. After that, the Happy Prince also again requested that tomorrow, please don't go to Egypt and stay one more day for me. The swallow said that the weather is not going to be favorable as the winter is approaching here. Soon it will start. The snow will start coming down and ultimately I have to go to Egypt. But upon request, the swallow again stayed for one more day and the Happy Prince requested him that there in far away in that city, I have seen that a playwright is sitting on the desk in his garret. There is no fire in the garret also. It was very cold. And ultimately, just a minute, please. It is very cold. And this is the reason why he is not able to finish his play. He is writing a play for the director of the theater. Okay. He needed some wood to keep himself warm so that he could finish the script and get some money. Now, Happy Prince told the swallow, as there is no ruby left, but his eyes that are made of sapphire, you can take one sapphire out of my eye and give it to that playwright. The swallow did the same and the swallow took that sapphire out of the eye of the Happy Prince and put it on the side of the table on which a glass jar was placed with withered violets. And this helped the playwright to get logs of wood to light some fire. And ultimately, he was able to finish his play. So in this manner, the swallow and the Happy Prince, they helped the playwright. Then again, the third time again, the Happy Prince insisted the swallow to stay for some time there. So what happened? This time, the Happy Prince told that there is a match girl standing in the city square. Her matches, they had dampened out because they have fallen to the gutter. And she is afraid of going at home because her father would definitely beat her. Why? Because as the matches, they have been dampened up, she would not get any money. Right? So after that, the Happy Prince told the swallow to take out another sapphire out of his eye and give it to the match girl. But the swallow was not ready to take out the other sapphire. Why? Because the swallow told that if he would take out another sapphire, that would make Happy Prince blind. And if he will be blind, then he would not be able to see anything. Okay? He would not be able to see the condition of his kingdom. But Happy Prince insisted again and again, and Swallow had no choice, had to take out another sapphire, and it handed over onto the open hand of the match girl who was standing in the city square. She recognized it. The match girl recognized that it is a piece of glass which is brightly shining. She has taken that piece of glass to his father, who recognized the worth of that sapphire and noticed that it is not an ordinary stone. This is some precious stone which is sapphire, and ultimately this changed the life of the match girl as well as her family members. So after that, the swallow felt little bit, you can say, emotional. The swallow felt that as you have lost your eyes in order to help people, so I would always stay here with you. Okay, I would always stay here with you and be your eyes. So the Happy Prince again next told the swallow to go around, to have a round around the city and tell me what is the condition of the people in my city, how they are living. The swallow had a round. It told the Happy Prince that the rich people, they are busy in merriment, they are busy in merrymaking, they are residing in their houses, but the poor people who are begging for alms, who are just waiting for something to gain, they are sitting at the doors of these rich people. And there in the under the arch of the bridge, two boys, they were sitting. They did not have any clothes to wear. It was very cold, and ultimately what they were doing, they were clinging to each other. They were clinging to each other, and the watchman had come and rebuked them to go away from that place. So in this manner, he said, there is a lot of suffering in the kingdom. Happy Prince felt very bad at his heart that although his complete body is adorned with gold, it is embellished with the sheets of gold, still there is a lot of suffering in his kingdom. He told the swallow to take one sheet out and ultimately gave it to the person who are suffering. So in this manner, one sheet to another person, one sheet to another. So this, in this manner, this had tarnished, or this has, you can say, made the Happy Prince lost its beauty. It was no longer beautiful now. So after that, one day in the morning, the swallow, it had gone. Where it had gone? It had gone to the baker's shop. It was eating the crumbs of the breads and ultimately feeling something uneasy. It came and sat at the base of the statue of Happy Prince. There, what happened, because it was winter was approaching, the weather was not favorable, and ultimately swallow died. Okay, and suddenly there also was heard a crack, okay, in the body of the Happy Prince. And what has been broken? His heart. Because why? But because the swallow was dead. Okay, so the heart of Happy Prince, it also became dead. And ultimately, later on, what happened? Yes, Dhavnesh? Yes, town mayor. Next, afterwards, the mayor, along with its counselors, he came over for a round in the city. So when he came, Khushi, sit properly. Okay, so when he came into the city, he has noticed that the statue of the Happy Prince, it is no longer beautiful. It has lost its beauty. It is no longer embellished with gold. It is in its tarnished condition. It has turned out to be only a, you can say, statue of iron, which is diminishing, which is deteriorating the beauty of the city. So the mayor, along with his counselors, Keshav, sit properly. Open up a notebook in front of you. So he, along after discussion with the counselors, announced that what he has announced, that this statue is to be removed from here, and ultimately what is to be done? It has to be thrown onto the heap of trash. So before that, it should be melted in a furnace. So the statue of the Happy Prince, it has been brought down. It was melted in furnace, but because the heart, which is made up of lead, is no longer prone to melt in the furnace, it was thrown on the heap of trash or rubble. Okay, so there the dead swallow, which was found to be sitting or to have fallen at the base of the Happy Prince, was also taken from there, and where it was thrown onto the heap of rubble. So there, what happened? So on the other side, one day the god asked his angels to find two most precious things from the world. They had a round of the world and ultimately came to take swallow, dead body of swallow, to God, as well as the lead heart of Happy Prince. Why? Okay. And they thought that these are the two most precious things in this entire world. Okay. Why? Because swallow has sacrificed its body in order to help Happy Prince, to help others. And Happy Prince, who is weeping its tears, who is weeping his eyes, and ultimately gave everything that is adorned its statue. To whom? To whom it has given? To the people who were suffering. And ultimately, he sacrificed his entire beauty to help others. So in this manner, what happened? So the god announced that the swallow will always sing in the garden of heaven, and Happy Prince will always praise him in the heaven. So ultimately, what this story tells us? This story tells us that people who help others, who always help others, who always have a soft corner for others, who always feel, you can say, pity for the poor condition of others, they are always praised in the house of God. And they are always welcome in the house of God. Okay? Clear? Happy Prince, clear? Any doubts? So, let me take a short overlook over the chapter. Why it is called as Happy Prince? Because it has never seen any kind of suffering in his entire life. And later on, after that, what was the body of the Happy Prince was made up of? Its body was made up of gold. Okay, it was embellished with gold, but his heart was made up of lead. And there is a ruby in the sword hilt, and two eyes were made up of sapphires. Okay, what was to whom the ruby was given? To the seamstress who was embroidering the flowers on the satin gowns of the maids of honor for the queen, okay, for the ballroom dance. And later on, out of the two fires, first fire was given to the playwright, and the second fire was given to the match girl. And ultimately, when the swallow had a round over the city, what did it notice? That the people are suffering, rich people making merriment, poor are suffering. Two boys sitting under an arch, clinging together in order to keep their bodies warm. Watchmen came and rebuked them and scolded them to go away from that arch of bridge. Okay, right, clear? Why dead swallow as well as the heart of Happy Prince considered to be the two most precious things? Because they help others. Okay, they have sacrificed their life for others, and even such people who sacrifice their lives for the happiness of others, to help others, and ultimately they are always appreciated in the house of God, and ultimately they are the two most precious things in the world. Okay, clear this chapter? Fine. Last boy, sit properly. Now next chapter is Withering the Storm in Arsama. Okay, so now on 27 October 1999, so Prashant has gone to 18 kilometers away from Arsama to his friend's house. Why he has gone there? To spend two nights with him. Okay, so but what happened? Because of the super cyclone and a flood, a storm inflicted at that place, and the entire area, okay, it was covered with water. There was water and water everywhere. Muddy sheet of water covered almost all the ground. All the houses, they have been shattered down. You can say great damage, great wreck has been wrought down by this super cyclone that has brought with it incessant rain and a lot of damage. Even the house of Prashant's friend, it was also submerged in water. And there was neck deep water, and ultimately they were not be able to stay at the ground level. So they have to shift themselves in order to save their lives. They have to rescue themselves, and they have shifted to the roof of the house, where for almost 2 days they did not have anything to eat. What they were surviving, they did not have anything to eat. Finally, on the third day, suddenly, or it was a blessing in disguise, that two of the coconut trees, they have fallen onto the roof. And for the first time in those 2 days, they have their first food, that is raw coconuts. For the coming 2 to 3 days, they were just surviving on the raw coconuts only, right? So the damage that has been brought by this super cyclone was that everywhere it was covered, that all the entire area, it was covered with water. All the houses, they have been damaged completely. Only few structures of the houses, which are strong ones that are made up of brick as well as cement, they could be seen standing. But if they are standing also, they are again submerged in water, they are covered in water, and people are sitting at the top of the roofs of the houses, and there were animal carcasses, human corpses, bloated dead bodies of goat, cow, cats, they were just, you can say, floating over the water. This has turned out to be one's heart filled with pity to see the damage that has been caused by this super cyclone. Now, when after 2 days the rain stopped and the water started receding back, moving back, and ultimately Prashant thought to seek out for his village. So what he did, what preparations did he make? He took out a sturdy stick in order to check the ground and to find his passage, and he started his journey. When he reached somewhat one or two villages ahead, he met two friends of his father who were also going. Where they were going? They were also going back to their village. So when he reached there, sometimes at some of the points they have to wade through the water only in order to find their way. Okay, so when they reached the village, the scene turned out to be more macabre. So what was the condition? Again, dead animals, bloated body, dead bodies of cats, cows, goats, as well as human corpses, they were floating over the water. They have to push away the dead bodies apart from the surface of the water in order to find their way. And finally, when Prashant reached the village, what was the first thing where he went? First of all, he went to the place where once his house was. Okay, his house was completely, you can say, submerged in water. There was no way to go inside the house. some of the belongings of his house, they were also, neend aa rahi hai aapko, some of the belongings, they were also, you can say, hanging in the branches of the, on in the branches of the trees. And ultimately what has happened, he wanted to seek the family members of his house, and for that where he has gone afterwards, the Red Cross shelter, because the government has started a venture in which the government is going to help the people in need. They have started the rescue operations, they have set up a Red Cross shelter, and there Prashant has gone. So when he has gone to the Red Cross shelter, no family member was to be seen. He thought that he has lost all the members of his family, but ultimately then his maternal grandmother, she came out. When she saw Prashant, her eyes were filled with tears. She opened her arms and hugged or took Prashant in her arms, and ultimately tears started coming out of her eyes, or tears started rolling down her eyes, and she was feeling quite happy. Soon this word, it spread around this, around the Red Cross shelter, that Prashant has come back. So slowly and gradually, when everyone came to know, then then his aunts, uncles, cousins, everyone came, and there was a reunion of the family. And Prashant thought himself to be quite happy to get his family members back again. Okay, now, so it was at that fourth day of the shelter, okay, that again they were surviving on the coconuts only in the shelter also. Now Prashant has thought that something has to be done. So as a leader of just of 19 years, he has emerged out as a leader. And first of all, the first step taken by Prashant was to procure rice from the rice merchant, who was not ready to part with his rice. He gathered some volunteers of the village, some young people, some old people, some effective people, and in order to pressurize the rice merchant to give a sack of rice, who has stocked it. Okay, although the rice was rotten, when it was cooked, finally they were successful in taking out, in getting that sack of rice. And when they got, then what happened? They cooked the rice, and almost the rice was half rotten, but nobody cared about it. So for that first time, everyone had food to their heart's content on the very first day. So Prashant, he as a leader, this was the first step taken by Prashant. Later on the next day, when on the fifth day, there was a helicopter who was providing the food parcels to the people who are suffering, or who has suffered this super cyclone, who has suffered the wreck of this super cyclone. And what Prashant did, he organized some young children and make them to lie onto the ground, and by putting them some empty utensils so that the light reflected would by them, or by the shining of the light over that empty utensils, they would come to know that there is need of food. Ultimately what happened? So the helicopter recognized the condition of that place, and ultimately they have thrown the food parcels. So next, Prashant, he has also sensitized the condition of the orphans as well as the widow women. So for the orphan children, what he has organized? He has organized polythene sheet shelter, where he has put all the orphan children together. Some women were also mobilized to look after them. Some women were also, you can say, mobilized to look after them. And men were, you can say, men were given the duty to secure food for these widows as well as children. Now the situation has turned out to be more grim. Everyone was suffering from the feeling of pain, from the feeling of sadness, and this even Prashant has noticed. So as he was fond of playing cricket, he has organized some cricket matches for the children also, so that to make them happy during that time. So the government has also worked for food program for the women, in which the women were working also, and they were getting food in return. And then afterwards, government has also started making separate homes for the widows as well as the orphan children. But Prashant has denied this idea of keeping them separate, as in this kind of environment, okay, the orphan children, they would feel, or they would be deprived of the love and affection of the family members, and the widows, they would be suffering from the feeling of loneliness. Okay, so Prashant, what he has introduced to this concept, he has introduced the formation of foster families, where the widow women, they have adopted one or two orphan children, and ultimately what happened? They started living together, forming a family. So Prashant is the first face in that entire, you can say, Red Cross shelter, whose face everybody want to seek in this kind of distressed situation, because it is just because of that reason that Prashant, he has, you can say what he has done, that he has helped the people to come out of this gloom, helped the people to come out of this situation, and has taken active as well as you can say stern steps in order to help the people in kind in this time of need. Okay, so with this the chapter Withering the Storm is complete. I have included all the important, you can say, highlights of the chapter. Any problem? It's fine, it's clear. Now coming up to the most beautiful story of this class, okay, of this syllabus, the last leaf story of two girls, Sue and Johnsy, who were living on the third floor of the flat, and Johnsy, who was suffering from pneumonia. Doctor was paying regular visits to her, but the medicines, they were also not showing any effect. The doctor has conveyed it to Sue that Johnsy has developed a feeling of pessimism. She has developed a feeling of an aversion to be cured. She has set up his, you can say, bend of mind that she would not be cured at all. Until and unless she did not have a will to live, she would not be cured. Okay? So Sue was quite, you can say, worried about the condition of Johnsy. She was trying various ways in order to indulge her into entertainment. One day she has brought a, you can say, board, as both were painters. She has brought a drawing board in front of her and told her to paint something, but Johnsy was denying of painting even. So Sue wanted to complete that painting in order to get some food as well as some money for them. Okay, and one day what happened, Sue has heard Johnsy, she's continuously looking out of the window and looking, and her gaze, it was fixed on the ivy creeper that has climbed on the opposite wall of the window. She was counting 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5. And ultimately, when Sue looked back, she noticed that she was counting the leaves of the ivy creeper. Then Johnsy conveyed it to Sue that when this last leaf on this ivy creeper would fall, that would be the last day of my life. Sue told Johnsy that don't act so stupidly, as there is no connection between her life as well as the leaf on the ivy creeper. But Johnsy, who has turned out to be so stubborn in her thinking, nothing is making happy. Even Sue tried to bring a bowl of soup for her. She was not ready to drink it. And she is also trying to indulge her, to entertain her by talking about fashion as well as the popularity of the things around. But Johnsy was not at all, you can say, showing any interest in all these things. So one day what happened? Sue went to Bearman, who is an old painter who is living at the ground floor of the flat. Sue poured her heart to Bearman, told the entire story what Johnsy is suffering from. And Bearman assured Sue that he would come to their house to see Johnsy. So when Bearman came, Johnsy was looking outside the window and again counting the leaves of the ivy creeper. Bearman did not say anything, and he has noticed that only the last leaf was left on the ivy creeper. Bearman did not say anything. He went back to his flat later on that day. It was incessant rain, okay? Strong wind was blowing, and Johnsy thought that the next morning when she would wake up, there would be no leaf on the ivy creeper, and that would be the last day of her life, okay? In the morning, what happened? Johnsy told Sue to draw the curtain away from the window. Sue did the same, and Johnsy was surprised to see that there was still one last leaf left on the ivy creeper. It has survived that storm. Johnsy changed her feelings now. She thought that how stupid she was, how stubborn she was to think that when this last leaf would fall away, that would be the last day of her life. But ultimately, that did not fall. She has revived her spirit of living. She is filled with the sense of revival again, that she will be fit again. The doctor visited the same day and noticed that there is a change in the condition of Johnsy. Okay, what it means, that it is only the will to live that changed her, nothing else. Okay, even the medication is started working upon when she has changed her attitude towards life. Earlier she was pessimistic, but now she has changed to be optimistic in her nature. So the doctor at the same time announced that he has to go to see Bearman, who is suffering from acute pneumonia. His condition is critical and there are no chances of his survival. Okay, so later on the janitor announced of the flat, it announced that Bearman is dead. Okay, when Sue went outside to see Bearman, she noticed that there was a ladder. He was completely drenched in rain. His clothes were wet, shoes were wet, and there was also a tray lying on the side of the ladder containing some green and yellow paint. She looked at that ivy creeper and the last leaf that was attached to it. It was nothing else than a painted leaf which was painted by Bearman. It means that Bearman, he has noticed the condition of Jonesy, and Bearman's lifelong desire was to paint a masterpiece. He wanted to paint a masterpiece, but his desire was not at all fulfilled. Sue announced that this is Bearman's masterpiece, which he has created by sacrificing his life. So that was Bearman's masterpiece. Why it was a masterpiece? Because it had saved Jonesy's life. It was that leaf that was painted by Bearman that saved ultimately Jonesy's life. It was just because of that last leaf that the attitude of Jonesy, it was entirely changed. She's revived back to life, okay? From having a pessimistic approach towards life, she has turned out to be optimistic. And ultimately, Bearman, for the life of Jonesy, gave up his life. Okay, he has sacrificed his life, and that is the end of the chapter. So ultimately, this chapter, it delivers us the fact that it is not only the medication, but it is the will of life that make a person to survive, okay? To be optimistic, to have happy as well as healthy attitude towards life is more important than anything else is in life. So this is depicted, and quite clearly it is, you can say, propounded in the story with the help of the character of Jones, okay? So any problem in this chapter, you can ask me. Main question is why? What was Bearman's masterpiece and why it is a masterpiece? Bearman's masterpiece was the last leaf painted by him and which was attached on the ivy creeper. Why? Because it has saved Jones's life. It was his, you can say, sacrifice, that he stood in the entire rain, incessant rain, and ultimately he had saved Jones's life. It was his masterpiece what is a masterpiece actually? An exemplary piece, which is made of, an exemplary piece of art, which is capable of changing the notion of others. And ultimately it has changed the definition of a masterpiece, that which is, you can say, which has exemplified that art can also be a savior. And ultimately it has saved Jonesy's life. Huh? Yes, Jonesy was suffering also from pneumonia. Okay, yes. Public missive, yes. Why I got it wrong? Because many of the students, I don't know what they have written, but according to the chapter, what I have told you was that it is a lot long letter written to the government. Students, they were copying it from some other sources and they are writing some other definition which I have never read in my life also. And I was just telling that I have not given this definition to you in the class, then how you people are writing? The matter is quite simplified over there from where they have copied. No need to explain. Okay? This is the reason, because I'm just sticking to the points or the content given in the chapter. Nothing else. I'm not giving preference to any reference book also. Okay, because sometimes many things are written to be wrong over there. Okay.